Zman alakat nerot of Shabbat. This is Siman Reish Samech Aleph. There's going to be four seifim. Sefek ha-sheha v'hu ben ha-shemashot. Right? So now, if you remember, we just learned in the last Siman, which was Siman Reish Samech Sifet, that when a person is samuch l'chashecha, what does he have to say in his house? So he has to say, yisartem eravtem haliku etaner, light the candle. It wasn't a question, you remember? So now we're continuing on that. So now it says, if it's safek hashecha, which is a doubt whether it's nighttime, which is during ben hashmashot. Now remember, ben hashmashot is twilight. Okay, that is twilight, which is the, it says here, kedesh yurilu shloshet rivimil, three quarters of a mil, after shekiyat hachama, which is basically shlish sha'ah, a third of an hour, minus a 30th. Okay, so if you would take a third of an hour, how much is a third of an hour? 20 minutes, minus a 30th of a portion, meaning a 30th, meaning you would have to take the hour, right, which is around 6 minutes. So that's why it's 13 and a half minutes. That's what we do. Anyway, we always say it's three quarters of a meal. A meal is 18 minutes. So three quarters of 18 is going to be 13 and a half. Capish? Because one quarter of 18, right? If you take 18 divided by 2, is 9. Divided by 4, right, is going to be 4.5. So 3 quarters is 4.5, 4.5 times 3. So 4.5 is 9. Another 4.5 is 13.5. Capish? So again, ben hashemashot, which is 13.5 minutes, which is safek hashecha, en me'aserin et avadai, ve'en matbilin et hakelim, ve'en malikin et anerot, ואין מערבין עירובי תחומין, אבל מעשרין את האדמי, ומערבין ותומנין את החמין, את עושה ותומנין את החמין, ממש, everything that we say in the memalikin is brought down to the שולחן ערוך. Yeah, so again, one more time. ספך השכה, which means that it's already after שקיעה. Once it's already after שקיעה, that we already have a doubt whether it's nighttime or not, now they're not allowed to take מעשר on something which is for sure חייב מעשר. So that's מעשרין את הוודאי. En matvilin tekelim means you're not allowed to do tevilat kelim. So if you have a keli, a utensil, which you have to do tevilat kelim, you cannot do it after shekiyah. We're talking about obviously on Friday afternoon, yeah? En madlikin tanerot, you're not allowed to be madlik tanerot. So a woman calls, okay, she's not going to call you up because you're not going to answer. But if a woman comes and she says, Rabbi, yeah? She asks her local Orthodox rabbi, yeah? She says, Rabbi, what am I going to do? I didn't light candles yet. Say it. 18 minutes before Shekiah. 18 minutes before Shekiah. Yeah?
That's every hour around the world?
No. Here we do 18 minutes. Some places in the world do 20 minutes. For example, in Yerushalayim, a lot of, especially Ashkenazim, do 40 minutes. Other people do half an hour. Of course, the bells, the sirens, you know, and the music is 40 minutes.
18 is the minimum.
Usually 18 is the minimum. I've never seen less than 18. You understand? Okay. So it says here. So if you remember, we said the so we said emat bilin, you're not allowed to do tvilat kelim. Ve'emat likin et anerot, you're not allowed to do adlakat nerot. So if a woman comes and she says, I didn't light the candles, Stefan, what are you supposed to do? You're supposed to say, you're not allowed to light the candles now. Because safek hashecha, she's not allowed to light the candles. Even though it's ben hashmashot. She's going to say, yeah, but it's safek. Not allowed to. Yeah? What's the only thing she could do? Exactly.
To
light the candles.
Yeah.
She asks the goy to light the candles. We're going to see it. And then there's a whole question, can she make a bracha on it even or not? We'll speak about it. Let's see. Okay? But he's right. Philip is right. Yeah. Then it says, "Ve'em me'adavin." They don't do eruv tchumin. So remember, eruv tchumin means you're going to put your food in a certain place, and then by putting your food in a certain place, it's going to spread you out in the two different directions. Meaning that if I'm over here, eruv, right. No, but there's differences in eruvin because that's what we're going to see now. There's eruv chatzerot. There's eruv tchumin. Eruv chatzerot means in the same chatzer, you're allowed to carry. So for example, can you carry in your apartment building? Yeah. Why?
My apartment?
No, in your apartment for sure. Your apartment is your personal house. Your apartment building. But you need to do eruv chatzerot.
I know that when the roof broke in the hurricane like 3 or 4 years ago, you were, no, so more than that, you ran here at Kolabaisi. He told me to do eruv
chatzerot.
The stairs.
That's called Eruve Chatzerot. Yeah, Eruve Chatzerot. So Eruve Chatzerot is basically like this. We have Eruve Tchumin and Eruve Chatzerot. Eruve Tchumin is a Tchum. So for example, if I wanted to walk on Shabbat from here to Hollywood, yeah, it's probably out of the Tchum. Why? Because there's going to be more than 2,000 amot, 2,172, whatever it is, amot, outside of the Tchum, of the city Tchum, which means that when it finishes the limits of the city, that's it. Some people even say, by the way, Hollover is a problem because there's no real houses in Hollover. Some people want to say, oh, but maybe the actual, you know, like there's little stands there, maybe that's considered. But let's even pretend there was no stands. The fact that at the bridge, there's no houses from the bridge until the beginning of Sunny Isles, that's more than 2,173 amot. Come on, it's outside of the Tchum, which means that on Shabbat, you wouldn't be able to walk there. You could go the other way. You could walk all the way to Miami Beach, because Miami Beach is always, you know, the houses and everything, right? And even if there's a little tiny strip, let's say, for example, let's say you would even walk on the way of the 63rd Street. So there's a little tiny strip that doesn't have houses, but it's not 2,000 amot. You have houses on the left side. And then once you go up the bridge, it's just that little tiny area, and all of a sudden you have houses on the right and left again. So, what? No. So now, one second. So now, if you make a big eruv, and that's why you're allowed to do eruv, you don't need to do eruv chatzirot. Here we have an eruv in Miami Beach, and in Miami, meaning Surfside, Bal Harbor, Bay Harbor, we have an eruv. So if we have an eruv, you don't need to do eruv chatzirot, because the eruv that permits you to carry in the city allows you to carry in your apartment building as well. But let's say, like what Philip said, let's say, chas v'shalom, the eruv would break. Or we never had an eruv. In such a case, if there's no eruv, so now you have to do eruv chatzirot in your house. Right? Why in your house? In order to be able to carry in all of the apartment building. Not in your apartment building, in the what do you call it? The complex, huh? Like in the building itself. Because if not, you wouldn't be able to even leave your house with a key. You wouldn't be able to take out the garbage. You wouldn't be able to do nothing. Because if you don't have Eruve Chatzerot, it doesn't help. So there's a concept called Eruve Chatzerot, and then there's Eruve Tchumim. So now, Eruve Chatzerot is between one Chatzer and another Chatzer. So this happened to us. In Venezuela, we didn't have an Eruv in the city. It was broken, and even though Venezuela was technically easy to make an Eruv, because everything was walled. All the apartment buildings had walls around them. It was all walls because it was, how do you call it? Because it was dangerous. So because of danger, they all had walls. Walls is the best for eruv. But inside our complex, we had to do eruv chatzerot. So we went to the manager of the building and we gave them money. We told them, listen, please, right, we need you to take this. We want to rent from you the common areas. By having the common areas rented out to us, we're allowed to carry within the building. But the Jew is not the owner of the complex. The Ruve Chatzerot means you have to combine everyone together, that now all the common areas are now shared and you're allowed to use it.
What's the condominium? You won't share the complex.
Exactly. So you have to rent it out from the manager, from the one that's in charge of it.
But your owner already, your own part of the complex.
But you have to do it from everyone, not only just from yourself. So if you go to the manager, he has the rights to rent it out to you. So you tell him, I want to rent out the common areas for every Friday and Saturday. I want to rent out the common areas. Here's the money. Obviously, he's going to start saying, what? You're going to start doing I don't know what? No. I just want to be able to use it, to walk through it, to carry things from one place to another. That's all that I need. No problem. Here it is. He accepts the money, whatever it is. And now you have the matzah. You did it, Ruvei Chatzirot. Now you're able to carry every single Shabbat inside the entire complex. That's called Eruve Chatzerot. What is Eruve Tchumin? Eruve Tchumin is that if I wanted now to walk, let's say I wanted to walk to Sunny Isles. Yeah? And now let's pretend that Hollover is not a problem. So I'm able to walk to Sunny Isles. Okay? But let's say I wanted to go to Sunny Isles, right? But then I said, no, one second, I can't go only to Sunny Isles. I wanted to go to what's afterwards? Golden Beach. Golden Beach. Yeah. So I want to go to Golden Beach and then Hollander. Yeah. So Golden Beach. So now I am in the tomb of Sunny Isles, but I'm not in the tomb of Golden Beach. So what am I allowed to do? So here, what I'm allowed to do is not, what do you mean add both of them? No, in the middle of... you can't. You put it in the middle. Meaning, instead of me being in Surfside, and now I'm going to Sunny Isles, and then I'll be able to go to Golden Beach, what I'm going to do is the exact opposite. I go to Sunny Isles, and I put my food in the middle. And I say, this is where my yeah, this is where my junction starts. So now, I have it like this. So now, Golden Beach is within my area, and Surfside is within my area. And that's what that's called Eruv Tchumi. That's an Eruv of a Tchum that I'm basically putting in such a form that I'm able to do. Okay? Very good. So then it says, Aval me'asinin et ademai, v'tomenin et achamin. So then it says, you're allowed, okay, so you're not allowed to do Eruv Tchumi. You're allowed to take off ma'aser from demai. Remember, demai means, right? Demai means you're allowed, demai is basically where you have a safek, whether it took off Trumot or Masot or not. So therefore, in such a case where you have a safek, whether you took off Trumot or Masot or not, so then that's called demai, you're allowed to take off ma'aser from demai. But since anyway, it's a doubt, you're allowed to do it. Also, you're allowed to do hatmana, tomenin et achamin. What is tomenin et achamin? You're allowed to do atmana during Ben HaShemashot. The reason why is because since the majority of pots, this we just learned, remember in Reshnu Chet, since in Reshnu Zayin, since the majority of pots during Ben HaShemashot are hot, I'm not going to suspect you're going to warm it up. So since I don't suspect you're going to warm it up, Tomenin et Achamin, you're allowed to do atmana during Ben HaShemashot. But what's the problem? You do atmana, I covered it up, you know, with for example, blankets or whatever it is. So for example, it could happen to you. All of a sudden, your wife puts something on the plata, and she says, you know what, it's not going to be hot enough. She could take a towel, then a shmashot, take a towel, tomini tachmin, put it on top. Allowed to do atmana during Ben HaShemashot. Number three, na'arevin eruvei chatzerot, she's allowed to do eruvei chatzerot. Okay? Then it says, umutar lomar le'eino yehudi Ben HaShemashot la'lik ner le'tzorech Shabbat. You're allowed to tell the goy during Ben HaShemashot, to light a candle for Shabbat. Right? Or to do any type of a melacha, which is tzorech mitzvah. Or you're going to be busy and you're worried about it. Says the Rama, V'chen mi shekibil lava Shabbat sha'a u'shtayim kodin chashecha, yachol lomar le'en yudi la'lik haner u'shad varim shetzarich. The same melacha would apply, let's say, for us. We do plug minyan, correct? We do plug. Even though we accepted upon ourselves Shabbat early, yeah? So we're accepting upon ourselves Shabbat at around, I would say 6:40, 6:45, let's say, yeah, 6:40, 6:45. Yeah, because what do? We first do Mincha, we do Shir HaShirim, and then we do Kabbalat Shabbat. We only accept Shabbat by Mizmor Shir Lema Shabbat, or for Ashkenazim Barechu. Okay, so if we're going to accept it only by Mizmor Shir Lema Shabbat, I would say 6:45-ish, right? So 6:45. The technique is before I speak, because they already said Mizmor Shir Shabbat before I speak. So let's say it's around 6:45, right? So therefore, 6:45 is still early. You understand? The halakat nerot of the 18 minutes is 7:33 or whatever. You understand? You still have a good lot. So now you could go, right? And even when you go home, you went home, right? You came home afterwards, and now you're allowed to come and you're allowed to tell to a goy, you know what? I forgot. Can you turn me on this light? Can you turn me off this light? Can you, what? Your wife, technically speaking, if she didn't accept upon herself Shabbat, so technically she could do it, but it's better not to tell her mefurash, but because technically for you, you already accepted upon yourself Shabbat. So since you already accepted upon yourself Shabbat, and for her, there's a machloket. What is a machloket? There's a big machloket between Rav Vosner and Rav Moshe Feinstein, I think it was. Rav Vosner and Moshe Feinstein, the machloket is that if you accept upon yourself Shabbat, does she automatically accept upon herself Shabbat or not? So usually we paskin to be mekel, to be lenient, that it all depends on what. If you were taking upon yourself Shabbat early because it was like a halacha, so then you're right. Technically, it could be that she's going to accept upon herself Shabbat against her will, even if she didn't want. But let's say you only took it upon yourself for convenience. You wanted to do early Shabbat, so you could go home, and you have the entire night. It's early, you could enjoy with the kids, they're not half asleep. So that's convenience, it's not because of halacha. So in such a case, she's not obligated to accept someone herself Shabbat.
Most of the time I go home, she
lights
the candles.
Ah, bemet? No, my wife always, by the time I get home, she always lights the candles. No. She doesn't take the same time. My wife doesn't take. My wife is my. We're coming here. I'm coming here at 5:55, 5:50, and we're already leaving the house. She's not you're saying around 6:45. No, so I tell her, you have until 7:33. Now, anyway, she likes to do it early because she knows it's important. So no matter what, she'll always do early. Whether it's going to be 10 minutes earlier than 7:33, whether it's going to be 20 minutes, she'll always do early. But it's not like a chovah. You understand? So that's what I'm saying. But it's not like an obligation. Yeah.
Shabbat, so I went home at 7:30, just lighting.
She's just lighting, exactly. But 7:30 is just the lighting, exactly.
So if we accept Shabbat for the whole house,
No, you're right. No, so then, but there, if I remember correctly, I don't remember now where, but let's see if we learn it. But if I remember correctly, what's written there is that she doesn't have to accept the Shabbat when you accept it, but she should try to do it that by the time you get home, she already just lit. No, she did everything. Kilu, that she did everything beforehand. Meaning that's what she should try to do. So that way it's not that you're in Shabbat and she's not in Shabbat. So that means you're getting home at 7:30. So at 7:30, she should already be lighting. So that way, exactly when you come home, she's already there. You're right, but yeah, meaning that if she didn't do it, okay, fine. She's still okay. And she's still able to do everything. You understand? But for you to tell her to do a melacha, it's much worse. Because then you, for yourself, I'm saying technically speaking, she should almost be on the same page as you. You understand? So to tell a goy, that's always for me. Because you could tell a goy, even everybody, after everyone accepted upon themselves Shabbat. It's benash mashot. Benash mashot, you could tell a goy to do whatever you want. No. After benash mashot, only certain things you're allowed to ask. And you're not allowed to ask. Right? Because it's already Shabbat after benash mashot. So it's not that you're allowed to ask. You are allowed to ask when it's called shoot. Right? When it's one shoot, which means one isur doraita, like one derabanan, which is telling a goy to do something. That is only going to be permitted, for example, to make a fire.
If you come home after Sinai, you see the plata is not working.
The plata is a big problem. Plata is a huge problem.
It's like a wedding ring?
Yeah.
Plata is a huge problem. No, but the plata is a problem. Why is the plata? No, but the plata is not on at all. It wasn't working.
It wasn't on.
Yeah, it was.
You have to reset the thing.
That means, but.
Yeah.
That's a problem. Yeah. Now, so there it's a big problem because there it's mamash ish. It's mamash making a fire on Shabbat. Now, you know, whoever said that you have to have hot food on Shabbat. You understand? There's a whole question. So usually in such a scenario, what we would probably tell them to do is to do it through a grama. So you would tell the goy, right, to put like a timer onto the plata. And then he sticks it in. And then the timer will turn on the plata. Kapish?
Yeah.
Because by doing that, he's doing grama.
And you can touch the timer on the time you want, but it's not plata.
Well, technically, yes. You're allowed to touch it. Well, obviously, we're not talking about we're not talking about electrical. The electrical timer? Which timer?
Not the one that's using the plata.
Even if it's a mechanical one, the mechanical one, you're allowed to. So the kufot are mekumo. Yeah? That's also a machloket. It's not that simple, but for sure, if it's off, you've got more what to rely on. Even when it's on, there's a famous machloket between Rav Eliashiv and I don't remember who was the one who was Mekel, but Rav Eliashiv says you're not allowed to touch those buttons at all. Nothing. You understand? But the other opinion says no, that you're allowed to, you're allowed to lengthen. Lengthen the existing condition.
The AC.
Meaning that if it's on, so you could make it on longer. You can't make it shorter. If it's off, you can make it off longer, but not. You understand? Meaning you could lengthen the status quo of now.
But the AC, you can make it colder, but not warmer.
No. It depends. If the AC is off,
if it's on, you can put colder.
Exactly. And if it's off, you could put it for hotter.
But it's
you understand? Meaning that you could always keep the same status, right? Lengthen the same status. That it's a big, huge machlok at Achronim. Rav Eliashiv was machmir in a lot of these things. Yeah. Rav Eliashiv. No. Rav Eliashiv was machmir in almost all those things. If you look in Piskei Teshuvot, wow. Very strong. But usually were lenient. I don't remember if it was the Shmir Shabbat Kilchata. I think that was Mikkel of Neuwirth. I think. I would have to check again. I don't remember.
Yeah? The manual?
Yeah,
the old one.
Exactly, yeah. But that one is not that precise. It's not that exact. Okay, that's why. No, but you're right. But he's right. He's right. You know, you need that. It's able to do it. Okay.